Well, students, let us start our course with a brief introduction to finance and especially the investments and how the derivative works. Let us start with the importance of investments. Let me put it from the perspective of what is called inflation. In 1970s, roughly speaking, earnings around 200 rupees per month, it means a person who is earning around 200 rupees per month can comfortably run a 4-member family plus have a good savings. Coming to 1990s, a person earning 2000 rupees per month can comfortably run a 4-member family and, well, they can save with little difficulties. Coming to 2010s, earning rupees 20,000 per month is just enough to run a 4-member family, and savings is still difficult. So you can see from this how money lost its value. So today you can see that to run a 4-member family, monthly grocery expense will be minimum 8,000 you have to spend. Weekly vegetables, fruits, and so on, you need minimum weekly 1,500. So if you are having 20,000 as monthly salary, then you can imagine how difficult it is to run a family. Okay, because in addition to these two, these are very basic. You need to have house rent, school fees, medical expense, and so on. So earning 20,000 per month is almost next to impossible to run a 4-member family. And that too, if you want to think about some savings and so on, it becomes impossible. Okay. So comparing to the earning and the lifestyle in 1970s to the amount of earning and the lifestyle in 2020s, you can clearly see how money has lost its value. Let us put this idea in a different perspective. Suppose a person in 1970 who is earning 200 rupees per month decided to lock his 1-month salary in an almirah in his house. Okay. Well, it will be safe as far as the money is concerned, the physical money is concerned, because he locked it very safely, he kept it. Now, he opens his almirah in 2020 and takes his 200 rupees and tries to spend it. Okay. You can imagine what will be its value in terms of its buying capacity. Okay. What he could have bought in 1970 for 2 rupees. Okay. That he can buy for 200 rupees in 2020. Right. So if you just go with a rough estimate that I have given previously. So with respect to that rough estimate, you can see that what he could have spent in 1970s itself and bought something worth 2 rupees, he has to now spend 200 rupees to buy. That is, his entire month salary, he has to just spend to buy that which he could have bought for just a fraction of his salary in 1970. Okay. So you can clearly see that his money physically is not robbed. Okay. His money is very safe. Okay. Therefore, nobody robbed his money, but somebody robbed the value of the money. So now the question is, who is the robber who took away the value of the money in this 50 years? Okay. it is clearly what is called the inflation. Okay, money loses its value as time goes. Okay, that is what is called inflation. If money gains value, then it is called deflation. So inflation means the buying capacity, okay, of money decreases, okay, or the value of goods increases, okay, as time goes. Okay, that is called inflation. Let me just give you an idea of how the inflation goes in India. Every quarter, RBI comes up and gives you the inflation rate. Okay, so I'm just plotting the inflation rate in this plot from 1985 to 2019, that is somewhere here, okay, and the rest of the things is a projection, that is prediction for the future. Okay, so this is how it goes. So at present, the inflation is around 4.75%. Okay, that is what, so every quarter RBI comes and gives this number, inflation it releases, and also it gives you the inflation target for the future. Okay, so that is the prediction. As per this, you have around 4, it means RBI thinks that the inflation, that is the rate at which the money loses its value, is slightly going to decrease. That's what, as of today, the RBI is predicting. So this is just an idea for you to how the inflation rate, that is how the money has lost its value in the past. Okay, so you can see that up to 2021, it was like growing, and then for some time till 1991, and then up to 1999, it was just, and then it started falling, and again from 2005 onwards, it started increasing, and now again from around 2013-14, it started decreasing again. Okay, so this is how the inflation so far went in India. So what it means? Okay, let us try to understand it little bit detail. There are two concepts. One is called the real value of money, and another is called the nominal value of the money. Okay, so the nominal value of the money is nothing but, if you come back to this example, see, you logged 200 rupees in 1970s, right? This money. And you opened the Almera in 2020 and took back that money. Okay, 200 in 1970 is 200 still in 2020. It's not that you locked 200 rupees when you opened in 2020, there were only 2 1-rupee notes. No, still 200 rupee notes were there in the Almera. That is sure. That is called nominal value. Okay. Nominal value. But it has the potential to buy only the goods which are equivalent to 2 rupees here, right? So that is the real value. Okay, so real value is something which you will calculate by comparing something. Okay, here the comparison is with respect to the buying capacity of the money. Okay, you may compare it with gold or other commodities or other things also. Okay, so given the nominal value and the rate of inflation, okay, see, suppose you have 100 rupees today, okay, you think that as the nominal value, don't compare it with anything. So 100 rupees today, you may compare it with the 100 rupees 10 years before, then that is not a nominal value. You just take a 100 rupee note, consider it as a 100 rupee, that is and call it as nominal value. And now you take the RBI's rate of inflation. Okay. Say, for instance, as I told you, it is as of today, it is 4.75%. Okay, percent. Now, putting that as I, you can find the real value of your 100 rupees, which you are holding today. You can see what is the real value of that money, say next year. Okay. Formula is given by this. So you take I is equal to roughly 4.5, maybe it is 4.75 as per the this graph, but let us take it as 4.5. And suppose you are having 100 rupees, you take it as a nominal value. Next year, by this time, its value is, this is the real value. Okay. So it's not that on your money, it will be written 95.7. Next year, by the same time also, on the money, it will be written as 100 rupees only. But the real value is 9.75, means that what you can buy for 95.7 rupees today. Okay, so let me write it. Next year, you have to spend 100 rupees to buy the same material. What you can go to market and buy for 95.7 rupees today, the next year, if you postponed your planning of buying, the next year you have to pay 100 rupees for that. That is what is meant by the inflation rate. Okay. So the RBI gives every quarter inflation rate, and then once it comes, you can plug into this formula and see what is the real value of your 100 rupees as of this inflation rate. What it means? It means this. Okay. Okay. This is all about inflation. Now, the next question is, oh, so if I go to put my money, lock it in Almira, I'm going to lose its value. I may not lose it physically, but I will lose its value. That we have understood very clearly. Now, who can save our money from inflation? That is the next question. Okay. So who can save? You cannot obviously lock it in Almira and think that it is safe. No, it is not at all safe. Okay. Who can save us? It is none other than investments. Okay. You don't lock your money in Almira and keep it, but you invest it. That is the overall moral. Okay. So this is one of the important aim for you to think about investing your hard-earned money. Okay. So once we say, okay, I have to invest, it is something which is must for you, that you have to invest your money. Okay. And invest in right assets. That is also important. A right investment not only protects our money from inflation, but also it grows our money. Thus, investments can also be used as growing our money to meet our future financial goals. However, to meet our financial goals through investments, we have to look for those investments that can grow our money much more than the inflation rate. That is very important. A financial instrument is a commitment of money today with the intention of getting more in the later point of time. Let's take an example. The most simplest and most commonly used investment is bank fixed deposit. A bank offers you a deal where you deposit 100 rupees, say, in the bank today. Okay, so you invest, say, 100 rupees today. And After some time, say after 1 year, the bank gives you your 100 rupees plus something, say 10 rupees, amounts to 110 rupees. So it gives you 110 rupees, say after a year. So this 100 rupees is what is called the capital, which is the invested money, or it is also called the principal. Okay. And the 110 rupees that you got, okay, is the maturity amount, is the maturity, and the time at which you get is called the maturity time. Okay. So this is obviously the capital. So the bank is giving you back the capital plus some money that is called the interest. So in this deal, you can see that the interest that you got is 10%. Okay. So the interest rate is 10%. Generally, it is represented by dividing it by 100. Therefore, it is the interest rate is 0.1. Okay. So this scheme is commonly called the bank deposit or bank fixed deposit. Okay. So here, what is the nominal value? So you can see that 100 plus 10 equal to 110 is called the nominal value of this deposit. What is the real value? Well, so you take the inflation rate from RBI and you can calculate the real value by putting this as the nominal value within inflation rate given by RBI, you can calculate the real value of this deal. So this is an example of an investment, which is if the bank is a government bank, it is actually you don't have any chance that you will lose this money. Okay, you give 100 rupees today, after 1 year, surely you will get 110 rupees for sure. Okay. So this is called the risk-free investment. This is an example of a risk-free investment where you have no chance of losing your money. Okay. So investment can be categorized into two types. One is risk-free investment. As I told you, it's any public sector bank, that is government bank deposits are clearly risk-free, and also any government bonds. We will talk about what is mean by bonds later. But time being, you just think government bonds, they are very much similar to fixed deposits, very much similar to fixed deposits. Only thing is bonds can be traded. Okay. You can buy or sell them in the secondary markets at any time, whereas fixed deposit, something you take, you wait for 1 year and then you get back your money. Okay. Otherwise, you just have to forcibly break it. Okay, so risk-free. These are risk-free. Why I've told only government-issued investments are risk-free? Because if by any chance, if government goes bankrupt, they can always print money and give you the your invested money, right? They can print money and meet their liabilities. That is what the technically what people say. Whereas some private firms, if they go bankrupt, then they will not be able to return back your money plus your interest. Therefore, you may have to lose partly or fully your money. Such investments where you have chance of losing partly or fully your investment is called risky investments. Okay. A very good example for risky investments are stocks. Okay. So buying shares of a stock, which is called equity, there's no guarantee that you will get back your money. Forget about what you earn as a return, that is interest in terms of deposits. You may lose your capital also, right? So therefore it is risky. Before going forward, let us spend some time quickly to understand what is the main difference between bonds and shares. Okay, with a simple example. So let's consider a person which we'll call as Mr. Mohan borrowed 100 rupees from you to extend his business. So assume that Mr. Morgan, who is your friend, is running a business very well. Okay. And he wants to extend his business. Obviously, he needs money. Okay. So, but he doesn't have that much money that is needed to extend his business. So he is looking to borrow money. He comes to you. And he's asking, okay, give me 100 rupees. Just for sake of understanding, I'm telling you, any business may need more money. But just for the sake of understanding, let's take it as 100 rupees. So he's asking you 100 rupees to lend. Okay. Obviously, he's going to put it in his business. Therefore, you will think, what is the benefit that you will get out of that lending? Okay. Well, the person can give you two offers. Okay. The first offer says every year Mr. Mohan will pay you 10 rupees. Okay. It means you gave you 100 rupees. Therefore, it is 10% interest. Okay. And he will continue this for some time, say 10 years. After the end of 10 years, he will give you back that 100 rupees. That is the deal he is giving, say. Okay. Another deal that he can give is, okay, I will not give you fixed amount as, say, interest. Okay, that is called interest. But I will simply give you whatever I earn as profit from the 100 rupees that you give. So that 100 rupees he is going to put in his business, and that business is going to earn some money, right? Whatever he earns, that net profit, that is after tax and so on, expenses, tax and all, whatever he earned out of your 100 rupees, he will just give you back, okay, to you. That amount that he earns, okay, whereas he will keep that 100 rupees which you gave as capital with him, but every now and then, whatever he earns after meeting all his expenses, including tax, he will give you that remaining that he earned. Okay, so that we will call generally as dividend. In this context, whatever he gives is called interest, and in this context, whatever he gives is called dividend. Okay, so these are the two ways that your friend can offer you the benefit out of what you are going to lend him. Okay, so this way of giving you benefit is called similar to what happens in bonds, and this is something similar to what happens in shares. Okay, that is equity. Let us examine these two offers a little closely. According to offer one, you can see that irrespective to whatever Mr. Mohan gets profit or loss in his business, okay, he agreed to give you 10% every now and then, okay, now every year, say, okay. So even if he loses some money in his business after expansion, even then he will put that money from his pocket and give you, okay, 10%. Okay, therefore, if everything goes well, if your friend Mohan is honest, you have absolutely no risk in this deal, right? This is risk-free, if we assume the honesty. Okay. Whereas, look at the other offer. If his business goes well, you will get some positive return, right? As net profit. If he is, after expansion, if he is only facing loss in his business, then, you know, he will take that loss, compensate it from your capital, and therefore you may also lose partly or fully your capital in this deal. Okay, but assume that he is a very able man, and his past history of his company is very good, that he is, say, earning at least 15%, say, in the past, and expansion, maybe he will earn 17 or 18 like that, then going for this deal is very good, because he will be earning 17% out of your money. Okay, in this deal, you will get only 10%. But in this deal, you may get, there is a scope that you will get more money. But what is the problem is that there is also possibility of losing your money. So there is a risk involved in this offer. Okay. But the attraction is that if Mr. Mohan is capable of earning more, his past history is good, then you may get more return than what he is specifying here. So these are the two perspectives. Depending on your risk-taking ability, you can decide one of these two. Okay, so that is the main difference.